You name it, you name the area of life in our community, and Jewish people have been involved since they arrived here in the beginning of the 19th century.
The contributions of the Jewish community to the city are hard to overstate. At the same time, I think it is a statement about the character of our city and sort of the ethos of Cincinnati, which is one of diversity and vibrancy and of an immigrant story and of finding home.
From WLWT, this is Let's Talk Cincy, presented by Western and Southern Financial Group. Put our financial strength behind you.
Cincinnati's Jewish community is celebrating a milestone, 200 years of being a vibrant part of Greater Cincinnati. Hello, everyone. I'm Curtis Fuller, and welcome to Let's Talk Cincy. The Jewish community is using this bicentennial celebration to elevate, inspire, and build bridges throughout our community. Community members are honoring their past while embracing the future.
It's really an opportunity to celebrate the many contributions of Jewish Cincinnatians to the fabric of our larger city, to our industries, to our arts and culture, to our political arena, to our involvement in the military. There are, you name it, you name the area of life in our community, and Jewish people have been involved since they arrived here in the beginning of the 19th century, in the early decades of the 19th century. So it's really about that. It's really about looking at this group of immigrants who initially came from England and Germany and then were followed by a second wave of immigrants from Eastern Europe, and seeing the mark they made on the fabric of this community. Like, there were Jews here, just a few, in 1817, handful of Jews. By 1821, a bigger handful. And in that year, in 1821, we mark the beginning of the community because a legal transaction was made for the first time. Up until that point, because it was such a fledgling, small community, Jews met to worship in their homes or in the offices of people who had businesses in Cincinnati. They didn't have a synagogue. They didn't have a rabbi. They just sort of winged it, you know, initially. And there would be traveling rabbis who would come to do certain ceremonies and things, but they really were on their own. Well, what happens in 1821? Someone dies. And this person named Benjamin Labe, or Labe, wanted to be buried with Jewish ritual. So what does this little tiny community do? Half a dozen people who signed on to this, they bought a piece of property and they built a small cemetery. And that cemetery is at Chestnut Street and Central Avenue today. It still exists. And it marks the beginning of a formal Jewish community because a legal transaction took place to purchase that piece of property.
And how life was then and how life is today is sort of steeped in culture. Imagine that black and white image of my grandparents or great-grandparents or your grandparents or great-grandparents. The center of Jewish life is family. And that, I think, is that old, that sort of that old-fashioned image of the Shabbat dinner, the Friday night Sabbath dinner, where the family is gathered and you say the prayers and the candles are lit and the bread is special and the food is special, and it becomes, we usher in that day of rest. We usher in our Sabbath. And that is, again, I'm thinking that is not just a Jewish tradition. Our Sabbath just happens to be on Friday night. I think it is a cultural tradition, and I think it is also something that hopefully transcends, and it is in the center of it is family. So it's a beautiful image to conjure up, those gorgeous black and white old-fashioned photographs with grandma and grandpa and the children at the table. But my guess is this happens in many tables across the community and across immigrant cultures. The Jewish history of Cincinnati is we're a city of firsts. For instance, the first cemetery west of the Alleghenies, Jewish cemetery west of the Alleghenies, is here in Cincinnati, 1821. This is the home of Reformed Judaism. The first woman rabbi was ordained here in Cincinnati. I mean, so we're an amazing city and a groundbreaking city for Jewish history. My hope for the future of this community is that Jews continue to contribute to the well-being of our city, to the well-being of each other, and to our children. Yeah. We've got a lot to do in the city and in the world, and I feel so positive that moments like this set us up for the next 200 years.
Up next, a center telling the horrors of the past so we never forget. Let's Talk Cincy returns in just a moment.
Welcome back to Let's Talk Cincy. Many early Jewish residents of Greater Cincinnati came to our area through Union Terminal. The Nancy and David Wolf Holocaust and Humanities Center relocated there back in 2019. Now the mission is to ensure the lessons of the Holocaust will inspire action today.
I see incredible vibrancy in our Jewish community today. I think the fact that our, I've probably said this a few times, but our museum being where it is, positioned where it is, with all of the assets we have in our community and the connections between the Jewish community and the broader community and the civic connections are strong and will continue to be so. The work we do is inspiring, and that's what keeps me engaged, of course, and inspiring on so many levels. But of course, it's all about people. And by people, I mean, first and foremost, the survivors themselves. I've been able to work with so many survivors and see the impact they have on individuals. Just yesterday, we hosted an event with a survivor, and when he took the stage, you could hear a pin drop, right? So their stories, also their ability, their resilience, their ability to go through such horrific experiences and yet come out and be willing to share with others and make something of their lives and want to give back to the community offers, on a personal level, great inspiration and inspiration to all that they do and the work of the center. I have also seen the way students, when they walk through our museum, we just, over the past few months, had every CPS ninth grader come through the museum, so over 2,000 students, and almost all of them were incredibly engaged, respectful, asking meaningful questions, connecting to their own world. So I get to see that firsthand, and it keeps me every day excited about my work and the center's own growth. So starting as a small grassroots organization founded by survivors and growing throughout the years, working with more and more schools, more and more teachers, more and more community members, and now to have a platform in this iconic historic space that is really the center of our city is really meaningful, and also means that, you know, people want to hear these stories and want to learn from the past and want to reflect on these challenging topics. And I think, you know, we start our museum with a question of how can we be the best of humanity today? We can't go back and change the past, but how can we be the best of humanity today? And despite the polarized times we're living in and the challenges, I do believe that all of us are searching for that. We want what's best for everyone in our community and our country and our world. Sometimes there's a lot of noise that gets in the way of accomplishing that.
The Nancy and David Wolf Holocaust and Humanities Center is located inside Union Terminal. That center is open Thursday through Monday from 10 in the morning until 5 p.m. For more information, call 513-487-3055. And still to come.
A unique program shedding light on the challenges facing Cincinnati's Jewish community. A candid conversation when Let's Talk Cincy returns.
Holocaust survivor Simon Wiesenthal said, quote, "The history of man is the history of crimes, and history can repeat. So information is a defense. Through this, we can build, we must build, a defense against repetition," unquote. Cincinnati's Jewish community is building with other communities across the Queen City to confront the challenges facing us today.
Jewish community is deeply integrated into the fabric of our city across different sectors. And so I am privileged in this role at the JCRC to be at the intersection of a lot of that work. In coalitions, you know, I can't speak as much to the past because that's not necessarily my expertise, but in, you know, today we are involved in so many different interfaith and intercommunity efforts, whether it's the Cincinnati Regional Coalition Against Hate, or the Cincinnati Festival of Faiths, or the All In Equity Coalition, or you know, just so many different aspects of collaboration across our community. And I think it's been an opportunity to say, you know, what natural resources, like, what do we have as a community, as a Jewish community, where we can really offer the greater community to you know, to make sure we're working towards safety and security and justice for all people. The big challenge of the moment is that we are living during a time of really what's an unprecedented rise in anti-Semitism in America, not just in Cincinnati, but really across this country. The Anti-Defamation League has, you know, tracks the number of anti-Semitic incidents every year. And this year, this past year, the most recent data is higher than any other year that they've counted. So since they've been keeping track for more than 40 years, we are experiencing this real surge in anti-Semitic activity, incidents, harassment, language. You know, and we know that, obviously, that, you know, we see that play out in some of the watershed events that have happened all across this country, shootings at synagogues and attacks, you know, arsons, graffiti, and other, you know, challenging, difficult scenarios. But, you know, we're trying to think really creatively about what is at the root of that, and how do we address the root of that? I think that the rise in anti-Semitism is a manifestation of some deeper problems in our society. Because of the fact that it's really trafficked as a conspiracy theory, it is a unique indicator of our democratic systems and fabric weakening. So when people start relying on conspiracy theory instead of facts, when people start, you know, digging more into conspiracy theory than relationships that they have with each other, than actually wrestling with differences, there's something going on in our democratic society that is really problematic and has actually pretty severe consequences for all of us. The fact that in 2022 in America, you know, I knew, I never thought, and I've spoken with people who are, you know, much further along in their lives than myself and who have seen more history, that we would be here in a place where there are security guards outside synagogues and Jewish day schools, where we are have our heads on a swivel while we're saying Shabbat prayers, you know, and for good reason. And so while we know that we have to do what we have to do to protect our institutions and to make sure we have security, we also have to think about what is causing this kind of hatred. So we're trying through this program to address sort of the foundations of that and to try and think about, okay, how do we get to the root of some of the things that are broken in our society that are allowing extremism, hatred, racism, anti-Semitism to migrate from the extremes to the center? How do we create a force, a diverse force, that can strengthen our civic center, our democratic institutions, and that can really inoculate our society against hatred and extremism, anti-Semitism being one of those manifestations of hatred and extremism. And that's what this cohort is doing. It's an incredible cohort. It's 27 people across many spectrums of diversity in our community. We have everybody from, you know, folks on both sides of the aisle in the state legislature, to school superintendents, folks in the arts community, heads in media, you know, business, and very different political opinions who feel that there are major things broken in our society and that the only way we're going to fix them is to figure out how to do it together. So we've been learning everything from, you know, the relationship between extremism and democracy, the way anti-Semitism relates to that dynamic, the way anti-Semitism and racism relate to each other, sort of the roots of conspiracy theory, what's happening, why is conspiracy theory so prevalent and so trafficked today, how do we address that, mis- and disinformation, how do we get a hold on that as a society, how do people radicalize, why do people radicalize into movements, you know, is it that people are just inherently evil, or is it more likely that people are looking for a sense of belonging and significance, and these movements provide them a way to find that? How do we reach those folks in advance of that road towards radicalization? So the beautiful thing about this program is it's not just learning. We're wrapping up the learning right now. But every participant is going to have seed funding to actually bring these lessons and sort of the nuggets of learning that they've taken away from this into application, into their communities, and in ways that are going to turbocharge their work, right, and benefit their work. We didn't want to be prescriptive about that. We wanted to say, okay, you guys are the best and the brightest in this work. You're doing it in different spaces. Let's connect you for a conversation together and for, you know, so you can have a network of folks who are working on this with you. And then let's think together about what we can do in community, whether it's in individual pockets or together in different groups. Like, how do we bring others into this conversation in a way that that force multiplies? So that's the work that's going to start taking place here in the next six to nine months. And you know, all we can hope for is that we can do our part to, you know, to make the little change that we can. Jewish is to believe in miracles and to live with that spirit of optimism. You know, over thousands and thousands of years of Jewish history, there have been, you know, years and periods marked by great tragedy and great, discrimination and, an exile and, you know, horrible periods like the Holocaust and others. There have also been periods marked by great innovation and great bridge building and great success. And I think that we as a Jewish people know that light always triumphs over darkness and that it's our responsibility to do our part in our time to be the light and to try and kindle that light. The program was named that way intentionally because, you know, actually it's sort of an homage to, you know, Dr. King, right? It's like, you know, darkness doesn't drown out darkness. Only light can do that. So we have to meet the forces in our society that are intent on doing harm and that are destructive with collaboration, digging into differences with each other, with trying to actually vision what we want our community to look like and lead in that way.
Yeah, that Leaders in Light program is just so fascinating. The participants say they are learning the unique challenges and opportunities facing our community to build a more inclusive democracy.
Still ahead, helping the heart heal. The local hospital at the forefront of a new heart surgery technique. Let's Talk Cincy. We'll be right back.
You know, since we started Let's Talk Cincy, I have received so much feedback from the public, and I appreciate it. So we want to hear from you. Email us your ideas. The address is ltc@wlwt.com. You can also watch full episodes or get more information on wlwt.com and on our very local app. You can also listen to Let's Talk Cincy on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. Finally, today, we are so fortunate to live in a community that is leading the way in making advances in medicine. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, heart disease is the leading cause of death here in America. At the St. Elizabeth Hospital Valve Center of Excellence, A new robotic surgery is giving patients a new lease on life with a minimally invasive approach. WLWT, Colin Mayfield has our story.
Heart surgeries, of course, are a technical process, to say the least. But with this new technique, valve surgery and specifically mitral valve procedures have gotten less technical and better for the patient in the last 20 years. St. E is at the forefront of that technical advance.
And the doctor said, hey, you have a heart murmur. And it was an annual checkup, and I hadn't had one in quite a while.
A nagging chest issue when breathing turned out to be a severe murmur that within 2 years caused damage to Gary Fabre's heart. An avid scuba diver, Fabre was left literally gasping for air.
The heart murmur will not fix itself. It is one of those things that you have to have it repaired. If you wait long enough, you'll have to have it replaced.
That time is crucial because it can dictate which route doctors go. Dr. Mario Castillo-Sang chose a state-of-the-art mitral valve repair that used a robot and a large screen.
We've gone from doing this operation through the sternotomy, where we open the breastbone, to doing it through a small incision, about an inch and a half, okay, that goes right on the side of the pectoralis, right here. Okay. And through there, we can actually see directly the valve.
The heart is stopped while the surgeon uses a camera to put eyes on what's going on.
For those who play a lot of Nintendo and video games, it'll come as second nature.
This technique offers a myriad of positives, from faster recovery and less pain to patients even standing or walking upstairs hours after leaving the operating room.
Patients get off the respirator, get the breathing tube out in the operating room.
Wow.
So our patients, before they get out of the operating room, they're breathing on their own.
Hours after Fabre's surgery, he was up and walking.
On a Monday, okay, and on a Wednesday, I was climbing six flights of stairs. And I wasn't out of breath.
And now weeks have passed, and he's only gotten stronger.
Since then, and that's only been five and a half weeks ago, I've been able to do a lot of the things I was able to do before.
So as we know, every heart has a story, and at the center of every story, a patient like Gary Fabre, ready to create awareness. Colin Mayfield, WLWT News 5.
What a fascinating technique. You know, the Mayo Clinic says signs of heart disease can be different depending on the case, but some common symptoms include chest pain, shortness of breath, fluttering in your chest, pale gray or blue skin color, and a racing heartbeat. Well, that's all the time we have. Thanks for joining us. I'll see you next time for another edition of Let's Talk Cincy.